New era in traditional herbal medicine. Can traditional herbal medicine be improved? Dr. Jing-Ke Weng is a member of the Whitehead Institute. He received his PhD in biochemistry from Purdue University. He did his postdoctoral research with Dr. Joseph Noel at the Salk Institute for Biological Sciences and Howard Hughes Medical Institute. In 2013, he joined the Whitehead Institute and the biology department at MIT as an assistant professor. His research focuses on understanding the origin and evolution of plant-specialized metabolic systems. Welcome, and we can't wait to hear about your research.
All right.
Try my best to just convey my take on the whole entire herbal medicine topic. And I'll kind of describe what are the fundamental characteristics about herbal medicine and how we can improve or even reinvent herbal medicine to benefit human health in the modern society. So before I talk about traditional herbal medicine, I would like to discuss briefly how the first chemotherapy drug was discovered in Western medicine. So this is Dr. Sidney Farber. So in 1940, so he was working in a very dark laboratory in the basement of Harvard Medical School. And he was seeing these children patients with leukemia. And he realized that by looking at the blood sample of these patients, he can count the premature lymphocyte cells and their growth, and this can be a good handle to evaluate how good a potential drug can cure cancer. So at that time, with very little regulations, he actually experimented on his patients and typically under desperation situations. And he eventually found a class of antifolate metabolites. For example, this amidoterrene can cause temporary remissions of cancer. So then we're going back to 500 years before Dr. Sidney Farber. So another man on another side of the earth. So his name is Li Shizhen. So he's considered as one of the greatest herbologists in China and also scientists, and he's good for many different things. But one thing he bears in common with Dr. Sidney Farber, he cares about his patients and he wants to cure them. And he also spent his lifetime experimenting all different kinds of herbs, not only on his own patients, but also on himself. And finished this particular book called The Compendium of Materia Medica, which he spent 27 years on. So this particular book contains over 1,800 therapeutic substances, including 1,100 plant medicines, and also 11,000 prescriptions on these. So many of these substances, as illustrated here, are still being used. So this particular plant known as Artisia or coral berry is used in treating inflammation diseases in a lot of diseases. And also this particular plant called Fiscocliana is used in easing coughing and asthma. So of course this is only one of the classical books on Chinese traditional medicine. So as I dig into this particular information, I noticed there are at least 20 classical books on this topic, and with the earliest being dated back to 300 BC, this particular divine farmer's Materia Medica. So these classical books are still being studied intensively by the medical students studying Chinese traditional medicine in China. And the plants make the bulk of the prescriptions describing these books. So why plants can cure human disease? So if we look at plants, so they evolved into this terrestrial environment around 500 million years ago from their ancestors in the aquatic environments. So when these early plants come onto land, they have a lot of stresses they have to deal with. So they have to withstand the drought, the UV radiation, the ability to stand upright in the terrestrial environment. And also they face tremendous challenge from the co-evolving insects, including a lot of the pathogens and herbivores that are going to try to eat them. So they're not like animals can actively move around. They're sessile organisms, so they took a very unique evolutionary strategy, that is to expand their chemistry. So there are more than 100,000 natural products have been reported in plants. So many of these plant metabolites, known as secondary metabolites, are involved in interacting with insects, for example, attracting pollinating insects or seed dispersers, or serve as toxins or repellents to deter herbivores and pathogens. So since many of these metabolites have been involved in interspecies communication and interaction, no wonder when we humans consume them, they can also interact with our body in many different ways and sometimes lead to therapeutic effects. So for us to better understand how traditional Chinese herbal medicine actually works, let's first learn some fundamental methods how illness is diagnosed in traditional Chinese medicine. So there are four fundamental methods, so known as Wang, Wen, Wen, Qie. So these are observation, auscultation, and olfaction, inquiry, pulse feeding, and palpation. So in the early days when there's no knowledge about disease mechanisms, so the phenotypes or the symptoms related to certain disease are extremely important for the doctors to correctly diagnose and prescribe drugs for the patients. So indeed, Chinese traditional medicine have very detailed descriptions about all different kinds of symptoms in all their classical literature. And many, many prescriptions have been developed only based on the improvement of these symptoms. And these are all done over thousands of years on human subjects. So I want to raise just two examples showing why phenotypes or symptoms are important for traditional Chinese medicine. So this is a tongue reading. This is probably the first thing a Chinese doctor would do when you see them. This is also something you can do at home. And it happens that our tongue, the surface of tongue, is extremely sensitive to reflect the health state of our body. And I just got a cold a month ago. I was looking at my tongue, especially the second day of that illness. I saw my tongue was like this. So it's kind of whitish. And you also see the teeth marks on the side. And this tells me, okay, qi deficiency, what does that mean? So as you can see, there are a lot of theory going behind this. But now I think it's time to connect modern science to these old concepts these doctors have. But it's extremely true for me that I've seen many of these states in myself when I'm undergoing a different kind of illness. So this is something I encourage you to look at your tongue when you don't feel well. So the other thing is pulse feeding. So this is also something I don't really understand, and it took many, many years to learn. So based on the frequency, strength, and the pattern of the pulse, a very experienced Chinese doctor can tell what's going wrong with the patient. And I'm very glad to see that now there are medical device companies that are developing these devices, and by reading of these devices, you can give a pretty much good indication what's going on with your body. So I think this has a lot of interest in the future in the traditional medicine market in China. So the second very important characteristic for Chinese traditional medicine is it's actually a form of combinatorial and personalized medicine. So this is a really hot topic, but it's not new. So in Chinese traditional medicine, it has been always personalized. So on the left, it's a very typical prescription for herbal medicine. So this is from early 19th century and describing a patient with a long-term headache and coughing and sometimes with fever. So then this doctor prescribed 10 different components. So these are all plants, except one. So most of these are plants and also with very personalized quantity for each one. So these are the weight for each particular material, and the patient will just take that prescription and goes to a pharmacy and get your the prescription refilled. And to make a particular medicine, so you just mix all these herbs and boil it, and you drink the liquid out of this. So I talked about how symptoms are extremely important in traditional Chinese medicine. And all these prescriptions are based on improving symptoms. So here are two very successful examples. So this particular plant, gymnemus, it's used for treating excessive thirst. So there are a lot of literatures talking about the function of this plant in reduced excessive thirst. And it turns out it's a very good antibiotic, diabetic drug, and still being widely used today. So you can actually buy the food supplements this from Amazon. So the other one, Galega officialis or Gochu, it's also an antibiotic herbal. And it's described not only in Chinese traditional medicine, but also in medieval Europe. So it was used to treating excessive thirst and also painful urination. And so there's a compound being isolated in early 19th century, Galegian. It's a guanidine-containing molecule eventually being developed into a first-line antibiotic drug used in the market nowadays. So anti-inflammation is another area that Chinese traditional medicine is very good at. So this particular drug called Yunnan Baiyao, so this is hemostatic, anti-inflammatory, and it's extremely good for wound healing. So this is probably the most popular medicine in all Chinese families. So I have one. If you ask anyone, a Chinese friend, they have one. So the reputation of this almost rivals penicillin during the wartime. So the inventor of this particular medicine donated more than 30,000 bottles to the Chinese army when they fight Japanese army and saved a lot of people's lives. So as you can see, so it's a mixture of 10 different things. So this is the combinatorial nature of the Chinese medicine, which you see over and over again. And this is another amazing case which is now well-respected in Western medicine. So this is the anti-malaria drug artemisinin. So this compound is isolated from this particular plant called Qinghao or Artemisia, and by this scientist, Tu Youyou, and she was the winner of the 2011 Lasker Award for this particular discovery. So the thing that amazed me is that she digged into the literature, which dated back to 341 AD, and found this particular line describing an anti-malaria drug plant. So it talked about how to prepare this drug. So typically, I told you it involves boiling. But however, this particular treatment, you just soak this plant in water and drink the water. And eventually, they found that this particular molecule is heat sensitive. So if you boil the drug, the plant, it loses the efficacy. So now in the Western medicine, so the traditional drug discovery industry is facing tremendous difficulties. This just summarizes there's a very high percentage of failure rate down the line in clinical trials. Most of the drugs suffer from lack of efficacy. So this is a particular problem of mechanism-based drug discovery. You start with a very good hypothesis, but down the road you found, okay, something didn't work and something we don't really understand. So traditional Chinese herbal medicine are phenotypic-based. Many of these prescriptions are well-tested and have proven efficacies over thousands of years. So I would propose this could serve as a new source of new drug discovery in the future. So how are we going to do this? So there are three things I think we need to do to improve or reinvent traditional herbal medicine. So the first thing is to identify the active ingredient or a combination of ingredients which lead to a proven efficacy. So this is particularly important. So we want to start with some prescription that have proven efficacy, and then figure out what are the active ingredients. Second is to use modern molecular genetics biochemical approaches to figure out what are the action mechanisms for these compounds. Then we can start from the original natural products, then do medicinal chemistry to further improve this efficacy and develop them into modern drugs. So here are some data generated from my own lab. So now we have this fancy liquid chromatography coupled with mass spec instrument that can read quantitatively the whole entire metabolome of a plant. So this is just an analysis of the leaf extract of this goat's rue plant, which is antidiabetic. And I just found this is totally amazing. It's a galaxy of chemicals. So there are more than 1,700 compounds being reviewed from this simple analysis. And this particular gallogen, which leads to the efficacy of this plant, is here. And by looking at the data, I readily identified a few more metabolites that are related to this. But more importantly, you should think about when you eat the whole thing, you're also consuming all these metabolites. And the impact of these on your body is very hard to predict. So the other research is mechanism-based research. So it's very hard to figure out the mechanism by just working on humans. So now we're actually developing the plant model species, Arabidopsis thaliana, to study drug action mechanism. So this is applying metformin, the antidiabetic drugs, onto plants growing on high glucose. So actually, by using this drug, you can improve the plant growth on high glucose media. So now we can go along with chemical genetics approaches to figure out what are the genes involved in this response. So the other related drug, finformin, which has reportedly causing lactate acetylases, also causes deleterious phenotypes in plants. So this is another way to figure out why certain drugs causing adverse effects in human bodies. So this is another successful story, starting from turmeric, which is an Indian spice. So this particular compound called curcumin was initially found to inhibit an A-beta formation in Alzheimer's patients. So this particular product then was chemically reinvented and eventually gave this J147, now shows very good potency to reverse symptoms associated with Alzheimer's disease in mouse studies. So this is almost ready to launch into a clinical trials in humans. So that's all for today. If the last piece of message I want to give you, you want to stay healthy and eat a lot of vegetables, you're not the same with just taking the vitamins. Thank you.